Myself Priya Tawde. I'm an entrepreneur and I'm a business and personal development coach working in the field of education and training from past 19 years. First of all, I would like to acknowledge and appreciate all of you for coming over here, being present today and investing your important and precious time, not for myself, but for your own personal and success, personal growth and success. So I really appreciate all of you being present over here today. Thank you for coming. Thank you so much. Today's my topic is reinvent your success mantra. So before going to our topic, I would just like to ask that, do you really feel that sometimes you work very hard, but you fail to get success, whereas others get success very easily? We can see that some people without working hard, they really get very success, easy success.
Yes, common syndrome.
Common syndrome. So, do you ever feel that you end up into losses, financial losses or some other losses? Do you ever feel that it is very, very really struggling, you are doing very hard work for achieving success? So, if answer to any of these questions is yes, then my dear friends, you are in a very right place to know what is the problem to all these solutions and how to reinvent your success mantra. So why we see many people are very, very, very successful, and in spite of doing all the hard work and in spite of having all the resources, we end up either in some trouble or we end up getting very limited or less success as compared to others. So that it happens with one or the other person. Sometimes it happened with me also. So that I will come to a point later in the process. So what is, first of all, success? What is success? If I try to take the meaning of that word success, is gaining lot of money success? Is gaining lot of luxury? Is getting famous is success? Success word means achieving our desired outcome. Suppose my goal is to achieve 50% marks, and if I am able to do that in my examination, I am successful. Maybe a person getting 90, 80, 70, he might be having some other view that from that angle it will not be a success. But from my angle, if my achievement target was 50%, I have achieved it, so I am successful. The day we are born, the process of success starts. Life is a journey. And in this beautiful journey, we are every day one or the other, we are achieving our targets, our desired results. Sometime we achieve it as we have foreseen it, whatever we wanted. So that is our 100% achievement. But sometimes we not go up to the mark, what we were desiring the outcome. So that means, are we failing? So whenever we are not getting our desired outcomes, we are not reaching to that mark, we say that, okay, I am not successful. So what is success? A child born at a very early age, when the child starts learning to sit for the first time, it is success for that child. When the child starts walking for the first time, it is success for the child. When the same child goes into the school, learns to give his examinations, play sports, that is success. When a person reaches in the college, getting admission in good reputed college for a good degree, achieving the degree is success. Once achieved degree, we start searching for a job. Getting a good job in a reputed company with handsome salary is success for that person. This process is never ending. Once you get a job, now we want appraisal. Now we want promotions. We want more better job. We want a house. We want a car. One car you are having? No, now we want a sedan. You want something more SUV. So this process is never ending. So the ultimate thing, what we always say, he is successful, he is not successful, or I am successful, or I am not successful. That completely depends on what are the outcomes or what are the things we want to achieve. And if we succeed in attaining that, then we say we are successful. Otherwise, we say we are not successful. So this is the process of success, and what I call success is just achieving a milestone in our life. Our life is full of milestones. You know what is a milestone? When we travel by highway, there are roadblocks put aside on the road to mark how much distance we have covered or how long the next approaching city is. So we are, if I'm going to Bombay, Mumbai, from Mumbai I'm going to Pune, and on the highway I will get roadblocks on the side of the road measuring the distance, that now it is 200 kilometers for Pune city. After a few kilometers it will be 100, after a few kilometers 50. So these are the targets where we are approaching and achieving and reaching our station. So same way, life is a journey, and from our birth till our parting from this world, we are going from one or the other process and journeys of life, and we are achieving lot of things in our life. So when we reach a point where it is acceptable that I have desired to be a graduate and I did that, okay, it's success. Now no matter I was the first gold medalist or I was the last in my college, my desire was to be a graduate and that's complete, so it's success for me. But maybe for the world it may not be success. Getting a job is a success, but what type of job? Generally what happens? Now why some people end up, two children go to the same school, they do the same study in the same classroom, one ends up in a very good career and the other ends up in an average, and some did not even reach to that mark. So what happens in this process? So in this process, what we will say, the school is not teaching same syllabus to all the persons, the same classroom, all are sitting in the same environment, same teacher, everybody is provided with same resources, same textbook, same question paper, but performance is different. Why? What happens? Because if we say, I'll go through this first, what is success? Okay, before going to this, I would like to give a short story. Everybody might be familiar with the story of Thomas Edison, right? Thomas Edison and the letter which the school gave to his mother, okay? So what happened, Thomas Edison one day came home from the school handing a small piece of paper to his mother. And he said that, mother, my teacher has given this note of paper and had told me that give this to your mother and nobody else. So this has to be handed over to you. When she opened the letter and she read it, and he asked what is written in the letter. She was reading out the letter loudly to him, that your teacher has written that your son is genius. We are a small school and we don't have capable teachers over here to teach him. So we request you to please take him out and teach him yourself. So that was the thing what she read out. And tears were rolling down when she was reading this. After that, he completed his education, and after many, many years, after the death of his mother, and he was by that time a well-known scientist and achieved lot of things in his life. And after that, someday while searching for some old family things in the house, he happened to come across that particular piece of letter which was kept in a corner of a drawer. So he just opened it and read, and the thing which was written on it, yeah, that your son is adult, mentally ill, and we don't want to keep him for a moment also in our school, and please take him away. So that was the words which were written on it. So this story, if you believe the story is true, what faith it gives is, if the mother would have read those words when the child was very small, what would have happened? The child would have believed those words. Why? Yeah, he would have absorbed it, and that would have programmed into his mind, his brain, and he would have led that. He would have eventually grown to that level. And the same wordings were there which were negative for the child, but the mother on her own modified it and presented in a positive and inspirational way, that led to his belief that he is a genius and he has lot of talent, and eventually he absorbed more and more of that thing and he grew up into a famous personality, a scientist. So and went on for doing inventions after one after the other. Second, one more story I would like to share. This story is about one of my school friend living in my neighborhood. We all were growing in the same environment, in the same school, and the neighbor's friend, his name was Rahul, and Rahul and myself were in the same class, and we were of the same age. But what I observed when I used to go to his places, his parents, even if he drops a single piece of thing on the ground, immediately everybody in the house, no matter who is grandfather, grandmother, mother, father, everybody used to, whoever is present in front of him would say, "What is this? You're a dumb fellow, always falling things on the ground, always breaking some or the other thing. You're a dumb fellow, you are always doing wrong things, you are not able to cope up with your studies." So he was continuously from a very small age reminded or ordered, it was a command given to him, that you are a dumb fellow. And this, what happened in the childhood, it was not noticeable. And slowly, slowly, the intelligent boy turned out in his higher classes, losing interest in studies, always confused, low confidence, and he never was able to complete his studies. Later on, his parents approached help, medical help. Somehow they got medical certificate saying that he is mentally weak, and somehow bypassing few subjects and getting him clear through his SSC examination. But that stopped his journey. Today he is healthy. If we compare a mentally challenged person and if we compare that particular Rahul, if I compare both these entities, I have found that mentally challenged people are somewhat having physical deformity also in their looks, in their walking style, in their speaking style. But that person is just like you and me. But why he failed? Why he failed in doing his education? What happened with him? Where did he go wrong? So when I recollect now, that time I was also small, I could not recollect what is happening. But now I realize that what programming was given to him was always like that you are a dumb fellow, you are a dumb fellow, and eventually he became dumb. So his brain got the command that come on, you are a dumb and you cannot study, you cannot perform, you cannot be like normal person. So in spite of being completely physically normal, having all the intelligence, he can use his smartphone, he can go alone everywhere, he can do everything, but he is today not educated. Today he is not earning. What has happened? After, in spite of 30 years of age, the parents are still now looking after his financial needs. And now it has become like such a pain for the parents that how the child is going to survive ahead in life. So what programming they gave was completely destroying his self-confidence, his self-esteem, his significance. So these two stories lead us to the fact that whatever from the childhood to now, whatever we are listening, the children are very good observers and they are very good absorbers. So whatever the elders are talking in front of the children, or whatever the elders are talking, having conversation with themselves also. Sometimes the children are playing around, they are listening to all the conversation. So they are building their database, they are building their knowledge from that age about themselves, about the world. Now when a child is born, the child never know what is the relation between two countries, India and Pakistan. But as the child grows up, he knows that. So how? No parent will make sure that the parents will make the child sit and say, no, Pakistan is such a country, or we should be away from these people or that people, this person is bad, that person is, no parent does that. But eventually when we observe the environment and things happening in the society, the child automatically learns everything from that teaching. So that is the process. So what happens is our programming. Whatever programming we received, our conditioning, sometimes it is very good, excellent. The morals we receive from our parents, from our family, the way of living, the ethics, values, these are making us like a very good citizen. But sometimes unknowingly, no one does it intentionally, unintentionally these things happen. And we get the programming, wrong programming also. If we remember in our childhood, what has happened is, how many times can we recollect that our parents say, okay, yes, you do this, yes, you do that, yes, you do that. Nowadays also, even if we are dealing with children, younger generation, how many times we say them yes for anything? It's hardly. So if they keep on counting, we hardly tell them yes. Because the child is never going to ask, shall I study? That time we will say yes. But the child is going to ask other things only. So obviously we are forced to say what? First,
don't
no.
Do this, don't do that.
Yeah, so don't do this, don't do that. We now what, we are at a stage where we don't allow the children to fall also. Yes, we overprotect them. Why? Because we always say, don't do this, you will fall. Don't do that, you will get hurt. So when is the child going to learn? So every time we are overprotecting, and what we are doing is giving no signals.
So we're giving negative.
Yeah. So what the child is getting? Complete negative absorption. So will the child or any person going to feel that he is capable of doing anything right now? Because every time what he is listening is, no, don't do this, you will fall, don't do this, you will break, you will break this cutlery, you will hurt yourself, you will fall sick, don't eat ice cream, don't eat chocolate, your teeth will get spoiled, and eventually don't know whether the teeth is, if you see the research of medical science, even medical science now is telling that 75% of the diseases are self-created and only 25% psychosomatic disorders. So nowadays it is fashion that I am having blood pressure, I am having hypertension, I am having thyroid, I am having this and that and cholesterol. So that is a status symbol now. If any person is not having anything, that means something is wrong with that person. So this is the status symbol now which we carry on. So now why these diseases are coming, that is a complete different topic. Today we are concentrating only on success. So what happens is, looking at these two stories and the programming and conditioning which we have received throughout our life, or right now also when the young generation is with us and we are giving them, we are feeding them the thoughts in their brain, what thoughts we are giving them. So that makes them or breaks them. So that is very important. So if we start looking at what success is, suppose I say that I want to climb Mount Everest and tomorrow I go to the base camp and I start doing my things. So is it going, am I going to succeed if I have not done the previous basic qualifications and capability for that? I won't even be able to stand and breathe over there. So that success or failure is the result of what task I am doing. So result is always out from any particular action. When we take action, the action leads to any result. It will be either success or it will be failure. When the action comes, now a thought came to my mind that, okay, I should do climbing of Mount Everest. So feelings generated. That my action which I took was due to some feelings. And the feelings which I had is because of maybe attitude. Sometimes what is attitude? Attitude is nothing but the perspective of seeing at things. We have good attitude for some things, we have bad attitude for some things. If we are having good attitude for a particular thing, suppose, then that things are positive from our eyesight. So attitude is nothing but visualizing things from our perspective. So sometimes we have a positive attitude, sometimes we have a negative attitude. So our attitude determines what feelings are going to be generated in our body. Then how the attitudes are formed? How come I am going to have a particular attitude in life? The attitudes are formed by my beliefs. And what beliefs I am having? If anybody challenges me that, come on, if you go and climb Mount Everest, I will give you 1 crore rupees. Okay. So first I will think that in my past, have I ever climbed a hill? If I have not, I won't accept the challenge, how profitable it might be. But how did I take the decision now? Through my database, which is inside me. And I will say, no matter, 1 crore is very huge amount and it's very nice amount, but I won't risk my life or I won't do that because I have not done that. It's not my field. So for climbing a Mount Everest, having no experience of climbing a hill also, will take me 1 year of training. And after that also, I don't know I will be able to do that or not because I have not tested myself. So in that case, obviously my belief system will tell me that no, you can't do this task. So feeling will not be generated due to my beliefs. And how I get the beliefs? Due to the past, previous programming, the conditioning which I was having in my life. So I am getting my programming from there. So now if we see the formula for success, and now if we see, is there really a formula for success? Some people really get very good success and some people don't get success. All are in the same classroom, studying the same syllabus, same teacher, same education, environment, everything, resources are same, but the outcomes are different. So what happens is, what programming we have done, from that programming, our belief system is built. So our belief system builds attitude in our mind. That is the perspective of looking at things. And from those attitudes, the feelings are generated to take action. The feelings are generated to take action. And when you take action, there is a result. So if my result should be success, what should be changed in this process? I need to change my program. So I will give you an example, a real story of myself. Actually, I was in 10th standard. I have been brought up in a nuclear family. And my parents were both of them busy working. So they never forced us to study hard. They had always told me that you should study. And if you are passing, that's the only criteria at my home. Okay, happy. Because both of them are hardly getting any time. So they are completely busy doing their work. So they are just concerned only for that. My child is going to school, learning, passing at the first attempt, very happy. Where we need the signature of the parent, they will do it immediately. No red remark, no red line, happy. So my objective was to get good marks. So when I went into 10th standard, my SSC examination, at that time, 15 years back, there were no tuition classes, coaching classes, and the trend was not there. Whatever education you are getting from the school is the ultimate good education, and the teachers and your system is going to work. And we were really enjoyed our childhood, playing a lot, playing with friends, doing what all stuff, hobby classes, everything. Now the children don't get time to do anything of this. They are always busy from school to coaching class to school, and homeworks and homeworks and homeworks.
You need so many timetables.
Yes, they are completely. And I really feel, even in one of the conversation with the doctor, I was telling her that I really feel very bad about our children, that so many coaching classes now. She said, what is that? You never studied or what in your life, childhood? I was always busy in my studies. That's why I became a doctor. I said, I never studied so much. I was having plenty of time to do many things in my life. I had done lot of art classes. So that was the conversation, and I even got shocked listening to her answer that how parents are raising children now. Like, so when are they going to enjoy their life? So in my childhood, when I was very happy-go-lucky natured and very peaceful atmosphere at house, the main objective was my getting good marks. Now what is good? 40, 50 is also good. Not failing is good, right? Yeah, relatively good. So same books, same everything going on. And there was a system where you have a preliminary examination before your board exams. And after that, you get 20 to 21 days of leave to study at home, and then your board exams will appear. So I gave my preliminary examination, and few friends of us, we went to the school. It was in another city, and we went there, and we were getting our results of preliminary examination, and everybody was very enthusiastic. I scored 65%, so I was also happy. Good, 65 is good. So I was so happy, and one of my friends, she took up the result from my hand, and she saw that it's 65 and she had got 78. So she immediately passed the remark. Oh, how bad marks, 65. And when she did this remark in a group, and somewhere it touched my heart and it gave me pain, that the balloon in my head, which was 65 is good and I want to get good marks, was busted. And I realized that 65 is not good. And she has got 78. That means 78 and above, getting 80 and above is good. So my definition of good immediately changed over there. And God knows what happened to me. I went back home. 20 days only was left with my hand. Same books. I did not say anything to my parents, nor my parent took any effort that my child is in 10, so I will sit and study with her. Nothing changed. Same day, same everything, same life, same books, same environment, 20 days in hand. How I studied, why I studied, I don't know. But I never failed that I am studying for my board exam. I enjoyed that process. I gave my examination. When I was writing my paper, I was literally busy writing my own paper. I was not even knowing what is happening beside me. So I wrote it so beautifully and I was enjoying the entire process for the next 30 days till the examination ended. When the result day came in June, that was the time when the results were not out on internet, nor on mobile, no communication. So you have to go to the school, you will get the mark sheet in hand, hard mark sheet in your hand. So I went and no, there was not even a fashion of parents accompanying the children. So I went over there, my parents were working, both of them, they had been to their offices in the morning, I went in the afternoon, and suddenly while standing at the gate of the school, from one end I am seeing my mother is coming, from the other end I am seeing my father is coming, and I got surprised why these two are coming to school, because none of my friends have brought their parents. Then in what happened with me, it was how unfortunate it was. The school had announced a list of first 10 people getting more than 80%. And my name was not there. And my friend who had passed the comment on me, her name was there and she got 82%. When I went inside the principal's room to get my mark sheet, and I was sure, nah, it's not 80 and above because my name is not there. And she was also happy, her name is not there. And she has already scored 82. I went inside, I got my mark sheet, and my principal, I was quite famous, popular, so my principal, vice principal were knowing me personally. They saw me, they took the mark sheet and read it, and they both started communicating with each other that she has got 84. And might be they have understood that how come my name is not there in the list. So, and I was so shocked, I just snatched my mark sheet from the principal's hand. And I was checking the spelling thrice, whether it is my mark sheet. Because 65 in the preliminary examination, 20 days duration, and I reached 84%. So that was a shock to myself also. When I came out, and my friend was waiting, she was quite happy that 82, her name is not there in the list. Obviously below 80. And when I said 84, she also snatched my mark sheet. And she checked it. And God knows what happened, she started crying. When I came down, later my parents told me the reason why they reached school was because they thought if board exam she could not perform, anything goes wrong, she will do something to herself. So for my safety, they had come without informing me in the fear that our daughter should not go elsewhere and she should not take the shock because it's a board examination. And the happiness which followed after 84% and the belief which it gave to me. The moral of this story was the thing which happened in my life was like a game changer. That what belief I was carrying, my outcome was never well defined. My outcome was never specific. My outcome was just too huge, vast. I want to get good marks. Nowadays what people do? I want good salary. What is good? Salary, whatever you are getting is always good. A person who is getting 3,000 will say 5,000 is good. But a person getting 10,000 will say no, 5,000 is not good. So your definition about your success, outcome should be well defined. So in the process of traveling from your present state to your desired state, this process, today you are unsuccessful or you are failing in certain milestone, achieving the milestone, you are failing somewhere. And now you want to reach to your desired state. So in the desired state, if you really know where you have to reach, suppose you want to reach to Delhi. You know where you have to go in Delhi. You have the address. You will board a train. You will take a proper, if you take Rajdhani, you will reach earlier. If you take some express which passes from one state to the other, it will take two days, three days. So depends what mode or the journey you are taking. If you take a flight, you will reach in hours. So that is medium of reaching to the desired state is different. But if you sit in a train and you don't know where you want to go, then how you are going to reach? How your brain is going to do that for you? So what happened in my case was, when the good marks criteria was defined in my head, I want to get good marks. So passing the examination was good, and I was passing the examination, and my brain was having the definition that you have to do only this much. So in spite of having all the resources, everything, potential, intelligence, talent, everything, I was not doing any work. I was doing only the thing which was essential for achieving my goal of getting good marks. So when my definition changed, now I want to get more than 80%, that time the outcome was crystal clear, specific in my head. And at that point, I realized what is my goal, where I have to go, and now my brain automatically took the actions which were necessary to reach to that outcome. So the thing is, the success mantra or the key to success is with all the persons, that lies with your programming. So how you program yourself, how you program, what conditioning you have got from your childhood to your present state, the conditioning of your brain, your circumstances, your belief system, whatever has been done to you, then to get a particular desired state, we should change our programming. Now what to do? Change our programming. Can I go to my childhood back and change everything and feed a new system over there? It's not feasible. Yeah. So now I can't go back and change everything and erase. It will get erased over a period of time. It is not going to happen overnight. Because today I am giving you this information. Now this is information. Now this transformation can take place if you decide it. But that cannot happen today. I heard this lecture, I am going home, changing my programming, and tomorrow I am successful. That's not going to work. So what is there? You need 3 steps. First is, you should change the vocabulary what you are using. In my last talk, we did a session on power of words, that is affirmation, wellness through affirmation. So what affirmations we are using? What is affirmation? It is a words, positive words, which we are using in our statements. So what affirmations we are using? So that is our vocabulary. If we use most negative words, then we are going to be negative. And these negative words are going to destroy our positive energy or the cells inside our body. That we already have discussed. If you want to listen to what vocabulary we need to change, you can refer to my help talk, that is wellness through affirmations, power of words. Then second is, make outcome specific. If your outcome is quite broad, then it is not going to be achievable. Then you are not going to get proper success. And visualize your outcome. What happens when we study? If you see an advertisement, what happens if on television a text is written and an image is there out beside it? What we remember? Image or the text which is written? Image. So most of the time our programming is such that we are quite retaining things which are visual, which are in video format, are retained to a longer extent. If we watch a movie, everybody might have seen the movie on Three Idiots. There is a book also, right? Three Idiots. But if I read the book and if I see the movie, which is more remembering? If I'll read the book, I will understand at that time. But it may sound quite boring. But if I see the movie, what happens with our children? You make them learn a lesson, immediately they will forget. But if you take them to a theater and make them sit and watch a movie, each and every dialogue is by heart. Each and every dialogue. What is the sequence of dialogue? When the song is going to be played? Everything. Why?
Because more senses are involved.
Yeah, because more. Your yeah.
Visual.
Yeah.
And
so.
Apart from that, it has touched the child's interest. Also.
Right.
It's keen on seeing.
Yeah. So whatever the visuals, so there he goes, exact what I mean to say is more senses are involved. So when you visualize your result, when you try to visualize the result and the benefits you are going to get from that result, Suppose tomorrow a child's aim is that he wants a person, we'll take a person who has a habit of smoking, and now that person wants to overcome the habit of smoking. Now it is possible for him. When can I apply this formula? Programming is wrong. That's why his beliefs are that smoking is good. So he gets the attitude smoking is good. So he starts, urge is coming for feeling for smoking. He takes action and he smokes. Results are success or failure. Now if we say this format for non-smoking, a person who should not smoke, a smoker, we want to convert that person into a non-smoker. Now I want to apply this formula. If I will tell that person, okay, change your vocabulary, then I will tell him, make your outcome specific. His outcome is quite specific, that he don't want to smoke at all. Now what change of vocabulary he has to do? Okay, but what happens if I apply this system and I will say, when are the times that person is smoking? He feels the urge of smoking at what time? The feeling comes when? And that feeling leads to what? So I will have to sort out first that. Suppose the person says that whenever I smoke, I feel energetic. So now I got a clue. The attitude behind smoking is, he might be feeling that smokers are quite cool persons. It's trend, it's fashion. So that attitude needs to be revised. Then feelings. Feelings of smoking. When he feels like he wants to smoke, because either few of the smoker have the habit that they feel that till the time they don't smoke, they feel low energy. To de-stress themselves, they smoke. So if we take two examples, that he wants to get rid of the stress and he wants to feel more energetic. So these are the feelings which are generated, and then he takes the action of smoking. So what vocabulary I will change for that person is, first of all, I will tell that person to read out, write down these things in a piece of paper and read out it daily, that I am very healthy without smoking, I am a non-smoker, I enjoy my day, I enjoy my health has become very good, my family members are happy, this is the outcome of not smoking, my life is going to be extended, he is becoming more and more energetic. So all these things, vocabulary which he will change in himself, this will change his attitude and feelings. And then outcome is already specific. And then we are saying visualize your outcome. So he is visualizing himself now that due to non-smoking, what has happened to himself is his health has improved a lot. He has grown out to be a very healthy, energetic person. The surrounding people are welcoming him more, because nobody likes smoker, talking to smoking person. A person who smokes a lot, even if he is not smoking right now and standing beside me, I have experienced one lady saying, why the glass is smelling like cigarette? Why? Because 10 minutes back, a smoker went and had his cigarette, came, took the glass, drank water from above, but till the glass was smelling. So that is the effect. Now socially people don't like to be with such people. So this is the effect. So when he will visualize that I am getting completely energetic, healed, socially more acceptable, and I am enjoying this, and I am feeling more and more energetic, his automatic actions will improve, feelings, attitudes and beliefs and programming will change. For a student who wants to get very good marks in examination, he has to change his programming. What will he do for his vocabulary? I am very intelligent. I enjoy my studies. I always do my work on time. I always complete my studies on time. My syllabus is, I study the entire syllabus. I am very good at writing my paper. So if these are the positive affirmations if the child is giving to himself, and his outcome is specific that he wants 95% marks or 80% marks, whatever it is, not good. I want to get O grade, A grade. You specify the marks. What is your target? And then you visualize yourself getting that marks. If you get that marks, what's the scene now?
How?
As if you have achieved. So when you visualize that in your mind, the feelings also comes. Because if we right now visualize any of the family event in our life which gave us happiness, suppose the day of your marriage, it's completely saved in our muscles. Immediately the feelings also come out. So when you visualize an outcome with all the feelings also, your brain starts working for achieving that target. And everything, all the resources, all the key for the success is stored in ourselves, not outside. It's all inside. And we keep on searching outside that somebody will come and help me, somebody will come and save me, somebody will come and give a magical key from which I will go and get my success. But that's never going to happen. That is all within us. So if we want to change our result to success, we need to change our actions. And to change our actions, our feelings should be like that. Feelings come from our attitude, attitudes are from beliefs, and entirely we have to reprogram ourselves and reprogram our thought process, our belief system. And for that, three simple steps you can follow always. Make your outcome exact, specific, in detail, as much detail you want to write. You can overcome your illness through this. You can overcome your anxiety, stress. You can overcome all your bad patches, financial losses. You can start gaining more profit. And every single task which you want to be successful can be achieved by this. Any questions? From
inside.
So that comes from this only, na?
Until that burning desire is not born.
See, in my story, what happened? How the burning desire came? When I thought somebody is laughing at me because I am getting good marks, that is 65, is not good in others' context, and that pinched me somewhere. So the desire came instantly, and same books, same resources, and 20 days did a miracle. Otherwise, children keep on studying for throughout the year and come out with less marks. So that desire is generated by the pattern itself. We can't, it's very unfortunate, we can't plant it.
We can't plant it. The thing is, something like this. You change with that particular instant. Another person doesn't change with that particular instant.
Yeah.
Maybe he'll take a different
angle.
What they say. The same heat that melts the butter harder to the egg.
Yes, that
so
is true.
You never know what will change a person.
Yeah.
Again, to your example, I'm giving a similar one. When I was personal, which I'm a witness to it. And son of the Sessengers in a district place, an average student, going to government school, Marathi medium. In the library, once he was caught cutting off that cricket photo and collecting those cricket photos.
Yeah.
The library people saw it, he took it to the headmaster. The headmaster passed the remark to the session that you are an unworthy son to the worthy father.
Oh.
Touched the poor child, he went back home, he narrated the incident to his father and said, "I will no longer go to that school."
Oh.
This was somewhere in January or so. The examinations, he was 11th and SS examination student, 3 months from it.
So either, yeah.
Please see, because of his father, at that stage, no school would
admit anybody, right?
But because his father was dead, he was sent to an English medium formal school.
Okay.
He got it. Dropped his studies to Marathi medium.
And suddenly,
and over here, they had French and German as the second language.
Oh.
He had taken Sanskrit as a German
so
language.
Complete shift now.
The school admitted him, but he said the Sanskrit language is home. He said that language is very home and he didn't matter for Sanskrit. With this surprise, they have heard voice with the children, 20 numbers, na?
Yeah.
He came in the first 10.
Wow. Wow, very wonderful.
And subsequently, he went to the Indian foreign center.
Wow.
As an ex-student of the school, because yet he came back to our school, he was appalled when he passed his PhD.
Oh.
What do you do? He says, I just passed and I'm still working for my highest certificate. So is there ambition? And the words he used, I would like to be in the IP, Indian Forest Service, and I'm pretty sure I'll be clearing this examination.
Wow.
That was the confidence that just one remark of the principal.
So it's like either you make it or you break it. So if it is positively taken and touch the heart.
What the personality is?
Yeah, depends.
Say that that melts the butter,
egg, right. Thank you so much. You're being a wonderful audience.